It's Sunday, the 22nd of January 2017. It's United Kingdom Talk Live. Lucky to be here, to be honest. I had a few computer problems before. Let me just turn myself down a bit. Getting a bit of echo there. Yes, just before, I wasn't sure I was going to do a little show tonight. I was downstairs playing with the television and doing this thing with the cat cam, which is still running, incidentally. I don't think Katie the cat is on camera at the moment. She's got up from her bed and sat on the little stool that's right next to the radiator. So that's why you can't see Katie the cat at the moment, boys and girls. All right. But I came up here and I thought, well, I'll do a live show then. And I fired up. I've got a special computer that it's not special, just a normal computer, but a separate computer that carries the live picture and sound to you. It doesn't do anything else other than carry the picture and live, and also the little bits and pieces like photographs, like that sort of thing, and the films and all that business that goes in the sort of live programmes. And I fired up the broadcast software and it says, oh, a new version of this software is now available. Please update. So I did that. And after that, it couldn't see the camera. So that was about 9 o'clock. So it's taken me 2 hours to sort that out. But we've done it. And here we are for a little bit of a chit chat this evening. All right, boys and girls. Nice to be with you. Now, if you saw the show earlier, also being, what's the time now? It's about 11 o'clock at night. So this show will kind of cross over midnight. We'll probably be here for an hour. So we'll do Monday's birthdays after right at the end of the show today. All right, boys and girls. Now, can I just ask you, is the sound all right? Because I had to change something to get the sound working. So if you could just let me know that there's not an echo or something like that. No, actually, let me have a look. No, there isn't an echo. I can tell whether there's an echo or not. It's a little setting on there. And before I actually start chatting to you, before it's like live, there was an echo coming back, but it's not doing it now, so I think that's all right. Let's say hello to the early people. Who's with us early today? Let's have a look. Oh, lots of you. Good evening to Wendy. Evening, Wendy. Wendy's been out tonight. She took the old car out for a little run. Didn't you, my love? Nothing wrong with that. Trouble is, for me to take the car out for a run, I've got to get the thing out of the garage. Oh, no, I have to put it in the garage, dear. Oh, we can't have any of that scraping away of the ice in the morning. Oh, you see them all out there, don't you? And some of them don't have to take risks. Fancy leaving. My mate does it. Actually, my mate does it. When his other half, when sometimes before he goes to work, he goes out and starts his car for him, right? While he's still in the house, to allow it to warm up. I mean, that's deadly that anyone could jump in. I expect you want to know his address now so you can steal the BMW car from him. Yes. Very, very risky. But I don't have to do that ice scraping or anything out like that. You put it in the garage and that's it. We have a real parking problem here down the road I live in, Bracknell. In fact, a lot of Bracknell has a parking problem. A lot of cars now, you know, they've got several houses. Of course, when I was a child, the only person that had a car was your dad, wasn't it? Now, of course, your dad's got a car, your mum's got a car, you've probably got a car, and your brothers and sisters. Like, so one house, five cars. And it's getting beyond the joke. This road is particularly bad. But what annoys me is the amount of people that park in front of their garages. Now, I don't have a garage underneath or next to my house. It's in a block of garages. So there's, what, how many is there? One, two, there's six, seven, eight, nine. I think there's about 10 garages near me. Like one lot that side, one lot that side. Okay. And people, instead of parking in their garages, because it's full up with rubbish. Absolutely full up with rubbish. Now, I have to tell you, my dear Auntie Brenda also has a garage full of, I don't like to say it's rubbish. Before her husband died, my uncle Malcolm, they had two places. One was up in Nantwich in Cheshire. I don't really know the area too well. Nantwich in Cheshire. And the other one was in Tring. Now, when her husband died, she elected to sell her house in Cheshire and moved everything down to Tring. But she had too much. Of course, they had two lots of stuff. So she paid a removal firm to bring everything down, and she just put it in the garage, and it has sat there ever since, rotting away. And if I may quote my auntie, in case one of the children want it. Well, you know, great best wishes on that sort of thing. But they're never going to want it, are they? When children grow up, they want the modern thing. They don't want an old settee from the 80s or 90s. And this stuff is just stacked in the garage. And that is a prime example. A lot of the people around here have got stuff full, absolutely chock-a-block in their garages, tins of paint, and I mean, God knows what's in some of them, probably quite dangerous. You know, all these things waiting to be inflammable and set the old road on fire. But they have. And that's why the parking spaces are so bad. I think people should be forced to empty their garages. Yes, I am speaking now. Forced, I'm going to put notes through people's doors. That's what we'll do. Can I ask, is there anyone, you know, who wants to volunteer to make the notes in their own handwriting so I don't get caught? Eh? I mean, you can't print it off, can you? I mean, you might get those special departments in the police. Now, what do? You know, when they come with brushes and bits of tape and things like that. And they might find that they're probably come round to my house and they will check the paper and the ink on the paper to see if it matches up with what's coming out of my printer, dear. And I'll be caught. I'll be chucked away in a prison with all those nasty men. Anything could happen to me. Yes, just a thought. So we need a volunteer who is going to write out the little notes to the neighbours. Please empty your garage of rubbish and put your car inside. That's what we need to do something like that. Let's say hello to... So that's Wendy. She's been out for a little run in the car tonight. Hello to Sarita. We haven't seen you for a while, my darling. Lovely to see you. Sarita's there. Elaine's there in Israel. Hello, Elaine. Joey's there. Danny Davis is there in Manchester. Moving back to Welsh Wales soon, to Wrexham, to Greg's the Baker's. Greg's the Baker's. Julian Clark's there from Mallorca. Now, Julian, who is hypnotist? Am I right? Hypnotist. I haven't seen you for ages. From Mallorca. Oh, I bet it's warm there. It can't be as cold as it is here. We've got ice on the ground. Ice, baby. Bum, 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 bum. Oh, bum, 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 bum. Oh, ice, baby. Yes. Ice on the ground. Is that light on? Yes. Ice on the ground here. And hello to Mark Coburn, who says the sound is fine. Oh, I'm glad about that, because I wasn't quite sure whether the sound was working there. Hello to Jamie Clark. Jamie Clark has offered to write those notes out for me. Thank you, Jamie. You know, we'll have to think of a suitable thing there, a suitable thing to write. You know, dear, how do they go when they send a letter to dear occupier? That's it. Dear occupier. Please clear your garage and start moving your car back in your garage. The council is requiring this, and it'll have to be on Bracknell Forest Borough Council letterheaded paper. I don't have a paper. I'm a good boy. I don't really do anything wrong, so I don't get dodgy letters like that for the post. But we'll have to do it on the special paper as well, Jamie. All right. Good evening to Grant. Good evening, Grant. Grant is a DJ. A DJ at... George, I think it's called the George somewhere. I can't remember. Is it in Greenwich? Some people say it's Greenwich, but they want to spell it properly, dear. Greenwich, I think you are. Danny's there. Hello, Danny. Danny is a black cab driver, boys and girls. Always use a black cab, not Mr. Uber. Ooh, where am I going? Tap, tap, tap. One hand on the steering wheel, one hand on the sat nav. Ooh, where am I going? Oh, let me turn left suddenly. That's an Uber driver. Black cab driver, they sit in the front and they chat to you. Although I have to say, when your brother's in the cab with them, Ronnie, they don't manage to get much of a word in edgeways. He goes on and on and on. I got a black cab with him. Now, when was that? That was sometime last year. And, he got in the cab and he started going on and on. Quite honestly, I think the black cab driver was glad when we got out. On and on. Don't he give you a bleeding earache? Cool, dear. Hello, Danny. Hello to Rory, the lovely Rory. Irish singing sensation, Rory. Good evening, sir. And Simon Keane says, hi, Chris, are you well? Nantwich is up the road from me. 5 miles. Ah, from Crewe, yes. That's where my Aunt Brenda used to live with Uncle Malcolm and her two sons, Stephen and Michael. She's had a bit of a hard life, Brenda. She lost her son, my cousin, Michael, years ago. He had This is going back quite a long way now, at least, at least 17 years, 18, maybe about 19 years. But I had a cousin, Michael, and he had a Crohn's disease. And it's a very nasty disease. You have to keep going in, I gather, for, I don't know, I'm not a medical person, but I think you have to keep going in for operations. And each time you go in, you have another bit cut out, you know, so you've got kind of less and less inside you. And he took the decision not to have any more operations. So he went down the drug route, if you see, not, you know, not illegal drug, the drug route to prolong his life. And he had a brain hemorrhage, which done him in, unfortunately, caused by the steroids he was taking for the other thing, you see. So sometimes these drugs, I have to take pills every morning, but they all have some sort of side effects, some of them mild, some of them not so mild. Mine aren't too bad at all. What I take in the morning for something, not too bad at all. But, you know, he died from those drugs, so not nice. Sarita says, loving the blue shirt today. Thank you very much. What is the pin on your coat? It's just a little thing. I don't know what it is, actually. It's just a little thing there. Can you see that properly? I don't know if you can see that. I can't take it off. It's just it came with the coat. It's a, I'll tell you what it is. It's a horse. Hang on, maybe I can get that. Can I get that off? I don't know how it comes up. Just a minute, let me come closer. Come closer. There we are. Can you see that or not? It's a little horse. A little horse. Like on a chess set. What's the horse on the chess set? The chess set. Is that the pawn? I think it's the pawn. Yeah. The pawn. Thank you, Sarita. Hello to John Lauder. He's with us as well this evening. Good evening, John. And Rachel's there as well. Hello, Rachel. Rachel is in the house. Thank you, Rachel. Now, I've got a couple of bits and pieces. If you want to call in tonight, you can do so. There is a local London phone number, boys and girls. A local London phone number. And also a Skype in number if you want to call in at any point. Okay. I've got a couple of things that I'd like you to chat about today. Julian's going to call in, actually. Julian's calling in now. Hello, Julian. How are you? Are you my hypnotist, man?
Yes, I am, Chris.
Hello, sir. And how is it in Mallorca tonight?
Bloody freezing.
Is it cold there?
Bloody freezing.
Is it really? Are you on the Skype or on the phone?
I'm on Skype.
Oh, okay. That's not coming too clever. Are you still a hypnotist?
Yes, I'm going to do another year and then I'm retiring.
Oh, yeah. How old are you now, Julian?
I'm 63.
Wow. Okay, you're doing all right, aren't you? 63?
Well, I've got through cancer twice. And
yes, I remember you saying.
I'm taking it easy.
Yeah. Well, do you want to say what the cancer was or not? You don't have to.
Yeah, I don't mind. It's good for other gay people.
Okay.
I had testicular cancer when I was about 38.
Oh, that's early, isn't it?
Yeah.
Early.
And gosh. I had bowel cancer 2 years ago.
Right. And they cleared it both up?
Yeah, unfortunately, yes, but I'm left... how can I say? Well, basically, I'm... an invalid now.
Right.
I don't have a behind anymore. I have to do all my business in a bag.
Okay.
It's a pain in the ass, but what the hell? I'm still alive.
And you can still work as well.
Oh yes.
Where are you performing soon, Julian?
Well, it won't be till May,
right.
But it will be in Alcudia.
Whereabouts is that?
That's on the east coast of the island.
Right.
And it's a big resort. It comprises of three hotels.
Yes.
And I get an audience of a good 1,000.
Oh, that's not bad, is it? Blimey.
No.
Are you in a wheelchair or can you walk about or how does that work?
Oh, Christ, no, I'm mobile. I look like I normally do, only... 20 years older.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah. But we all got to get... I'm 53 now, I believe it. I'm 54 next month. It's not bad, is it?
Oh, my God.
Oh, yes. On and on, dear. on and on. So they're your two, because I was going to talk.
We are survivors.
So we are survivors. Oh, now what's that song now? Survivor, Destiny's Child, Survivors. Survivors, yes we are.
Exactly.
I actually had, fancy bringing that up now. I've got to carry this on. Yes, I had a camera up there a while ago because I kept getting to the point where I couldn't go all the time, and I'd be sitting there and it was awful, but nothing to be seen. That was, when was that? Back last May, that was. Nothing to be seen, really, and it's on and off all the time. They told me I've got IBS. IBS.
Yeah, that's what I've got now, Chris.
Yeah.
After this operation, I have IBS.
Yeah.
And I can go for 2 or 3 days, nothing happens.
And then suddenly and you have suddenly to rush. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. I don't know which is worse, actually, because you feel bloody awful when you can't go, don't you?
Yeah. But you feel even worse when you do, and you have to do it in a bag.
Well, yeah, what can you do, my love? But you're still there, and you're grateful as well, aren't you, for being there? I can tell.
Yes, I am. And, no, life is good. There is life after cancer. Yeah. I have to tell people this.
Can I ask what was the...
There's one thing I must say. I do feel so sorry for... In England, if I had cancer in England, I would have a special bag, no, box to keep the bags in.
Right.
But in Spain, you have to put it into the bins on the sidewalk.
Oh, right.
I just feel sorry for the poor refugees who go through the bins.
Oh, you are terrible, dear. I never thought about that. Well, all they'd find in my bin would be cat litter.
Oh, yeah, mine too.
She's quite old now, so she doesn't, you know, quite manage to go outside anymore. So she uses the cat litter. That's when she gets to the tray. Sometimes, every day I have to wash the kitchen floor now. But we love our pets. I've got a cat. She's 18 years old and all that business. So, yeah, it's hard work, isn't it? Anyway, Julian, thank you so much for calling in.
Thank you, Chris. It's good to talk to you again after all these years.
I know. I only ever worked with you once, wasn't it? Once in the Black Cap.
God almighty, yes. That was about 20-odd years ago.
Yeah, and you put some people into a bit of a trance, didn't you?
Oh, well, I still do.
I can't remember what you did in that show. It's so long ago now. But I'm so glad you're still working. I think work to you is quite important, as it is to me. Would I be right in saying that?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, got to keep going.
While I enjoy what I'm doing, I'll do it.
Yeah.
The minute I start hating it, that's when I finish.
Yeah, and you can now, can't you? You choose when you want to finish.
Jesus Christ, yeah, I can. Yeah, I've got a pension, I don't need to.
Yeah, because you've worked all these years hard. I'm in the same position, I'm doing it because I want to do it now. And how lucky am I to be able to do that now? If I want, I can pick up the phone tomorrow, thanks for him not coming back anymore. I could do that. I tell you what will get me, Julian, and I've said it many, many times on this show, the traffic. The traffic in London will eventually do my head in. Yeah.
Oh, tell me.
I bet you don't get any of that, do you?
I experienced it last year. It was a bloody nightmare.
Well, I go through that 3 times a week.
Oh, jeez. Monday. Good luck to you, Chris.
Monday, Wednesday and Friday. It's dreadful.
Oh, my God.
Horrendous.
I tell you what. I'm going to contact Kelly. She's my English agent.
All right,
I'm going to contact Kelly and see if I can do one last week in London.
See if you can get in at Central Station with me on a Saturday night.
Yeah, be good.
All right? You're getting a lot of love. Someone's sending you a lot of love hearts, which is quite nice. A couple of people sending you some love hearts there, Julian.
Well, that's nice.
All right? You have a lovely evening.
Thank you very much.
Lovely. Thanks for calling. Bye-bye, Julian.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye there. There we are. Julian calling in, boys and girls. And our lovely... You know, to come on and talk about something like that. Not everyone wants to do that. Lovely to be able to come on and talk to about something like that. Which brings us to one of our subjects tonight. I've written down a couple of subjects this evening. Are you ready for this? Here's the question. Have you ever nearly died. Sounds a bit morbid, but this is the case with Julian. Twice, nearly happened. Probably a few more times. They're only the two we heard. Have you ever nearly died? What happened to you? What happened? And did it change your kind of outlook on anything afterwards? That's what I'd want you to tell me this evening. If you have nearly died at some point, then let me know. My phone number is 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477. It's a local London number. All right. If there's someone on the phone, I can't take another call. We only do one call at a time. So if you call in while someone else is on the phone, it'll either ring constantly or it will go to an answer phone. Just to let you know that. But there's no one on the line at the moment. So if you've got a little story of where you nearly died and got out of it and you thought, that was lucky, or maybe just a serious injury, tell me about that tonight. 020-8144-3477. I've also got a Skype in. If you want to use the Skype in, my Skype username is all one word, United Kingdom Talk, right? All one word, United Kingdom Talk. So you can either phone in 020-8144-3477, or you can Skype in on United Kingdom Talk. They are our two methods of communication this evening, boys and girls. I'll tell you a couple of stories of why I died when I nearly died, which has happened a few times, actually. And you do, you think, that was close, you know. Let's just read some of your comments coming up. Hello to Jim Fannin. Hello, Jim, who says legend. Who, me? Legend? Aren't legends dead? Thank you, Jim. Hello to Alfie Devine. I saw you doing a little show earlier. Hello, Alfie. Danny says, nice for Sunday night. Thank you very much. Oh, what, the hypnotist guy? Yes, you are in my power. But I don't think there was any of that. I can't remember what he did now. It was kind of, you know, listen to my voice, anything but my voice. And I can't remember the show, but it was good. And it worked, you know, people were like in a trance. Simon says, the little thing on my jacket, the horse is the knight. Thank you. It's not the pawn. It's the knight in the chess set. I had an edible chess set in a cafe. I said, this is stalemate. He said, are you sure? I said, checkmate. Yes. Oh, God, please, dear. Thank you, Jim, for your kind comments there. Rachel says it is indeed a knight. Thank you. Sarita says it's cute. It's cute. My little knight is cute. Kevin says, hiya, Chris. I didn't know you was on. Well, here I am. On. Just. Hello to Lily tonight, who says, hi, Chris. Happy birthday to good friend John Child. Yes, indeed. We wished him a happy birthday on the show earlier today. John's birthday day. Is he? I think he's 45. He's certainly younger than me. Happy birthday. Hello to Guillermo. Ah, long time. Greetings from San Francisco, California, California. Here I come. I left my heart in San Francisco. Never been there. I haven't been to California. I know you've got a Disney, but it's a bit small. People have been to California Disney. It says it's a bit small. But I've got a very, very good friend of mine, Jacob, who's he's Israeli. And he lives there and he keeps asking me to go over. And he said he'd do the Disney thing with me in California. So you never know. Maybe one time. Maybe one time. Grant works at the George and Dragon. He's the DJ there. Hello to Kim, who's with us tonight. Jamie Clark. Dear person, whom may it concern? We should start with the letter, he thinks. Thank you, Jamie. Good idea. Hello to Ross Baker Hill. Hello, Ross. It was your birthday the other day, wasn't it? Happy birthday, Ross. Hello to Matt Martins in Canada. Rachel says, I think you may see some very fit blokes in prison if you get chucked in there. Yeah, because we're thinking about sending, those of you just joining us, very good evening to you. Welcome to our late night chat show. We're thinking of sending letters to all my neighbours informing them that they need to put their cars in the garage so as not to clog up all the streets around here in Bracknell. Please put your cars in the garage. And I was saying I might write out some letters and post them, but the police might get me for that with their forensic fingerprints and all that on the paper. Got a call coming in here from... oh, no, it's gone. I thought we had a call coming in there from London. Do you want to try that again? You might have got cut off there and I'll take you back again. All right. Let's go back to these and I'll tell you my story. Good evening to Callum, who says he's had a close call on his motorbike. Ooh, motorbikes. They frighten me, they do, motorbikes. You've got no, like, protection around you, have you? really, not at all. If you've got a little... Oh, there's the call then. Hello, who's calling in now, please? Good evening, London.
Hello, Mr. Reardon.
Hello, who's that?
Hello, it's Tommy Chris.
Hello, Tommy, how are you?
Hello, stranger. I thought I'd call you now after my bad Christmas and New Year, but nice to speak to you, fella.
Yeah, you lost your mum at Christmas, didn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, for the 22nd December. But I come down to see you, first of all.
Yes.
When you coast your karaoke in a wonderful, you know, your wonderful pub you're running over there. Well, not running, but looking after. And it's lovely to see you, Chris. It was really nice seeing
you. I remember.
It's like seeing an old stranger that I've not seen for years.
Oh, Tommy, tell me, did your mum go okay, you know?
Not really, Chris. No, she was got sent to the hospital about a month before, and yeah. she come home on a Sunday, and about 4 weeks later, she had terrible pains in her side, really bad pains. Her kidneys were given up. So I'll say this to everybody, she had neglected her diabetes in the early years when she had diabetes. She wouldn't take her insulin, cakes, fluid, drinking things, she shouldn't lucide, and in the end, it all caught up with her. So she died of kidney failure in the end, Chris.
Right.
It was the kidneys, but not a nice thing. I've done nursing for 22 years myself, as you know, but seeing your mum go like that in pain, and I must say, seeing her in pain, she had lots of pain. So, in fact, her cause of death was obviously kidney failure, but I think it was probably from the hospital we had to do. They gave her little bits of morphine that she didn't need, and we sent her over the edge. We had to do that because she was screaming at the end. She was screaming at the end, asking for help. And well, I'm running, like yourself, been to church this morning. So it's not, she was in a hospital environment, but... You know, it's just hard work and it was hard doing. But you never miss your mother till she's gone, Chris. That's a true old saying.
Oh, you've heard me say that so many times on here, haven't you?
I believe that saying myself. You never miss your mother.
I'm so sorry that she had a bad time going.
You know, coming back to the house was the worst thing, Chris, because we had the house. We were in the house together, and now I've taken on where I'm living, and it's coming back every night. It's not cold, but don't get me wrong. It's she's not here, and I'm expecting her to say, Tommy. Cup of tea?
Yeah.
I don't hear that word no more.
How long's it been now, Tommy?
22nd December, so we're very fresh. Oh, it's a month today.
About a month. May I ask, have you had any little signs?
Chris, I'm not going to go into detail about this, but I've had lots of signs. Lots.
Right.
And you'll hear people say this and they don't believe it, but the other night, the power supply went off in the house.
Right.
So I went out into the road, I went outside, looked out to the neighbours. All the lights, all the electric stayed on. TV, DVD stayed on, so I thought, oh, power line down. Mainly, no, nothing next door, nothing at all. And I went next door, I knocked a few doors down, and said, no, nothing. I don't know if people believe in this, but I'm a big believer. Big believer. I was at church this morning, as I said. I went to our Catholic church, Holy Trinity in Brook Green. And I went to the mass service at your old school you started. You said you were going to come to, and at Christmas time, you didn't turn up.
Oh, yes, that's right. That was the, yeah, because I didn't talk about it after that.
I went on the Thursday. It was absolutely lovely. That was the Thursday after my mum died. So I went up there. Absolutely brilliant. It was absolutely enthralling. My body went cold. It was so cold and so lovely. And the mass was absolutely beautiful. Really nice.
I told you you'd like it in there, didn't I?
Yeah, it was a quiet. It was lovely. And I'm getting into things. An adder and a plumber. I might go to one of these things soon.
Yes, okay, it's spiritualist service.
Yes, I'm not trying to delve into people who've gone over, but I'm seeing things and I'm hearing things that I want to hear. So for me at the moment, it's making me happy at the moment. So
it makes you comfortable, doesn't it?
It does make me comfortable.
Yeah.
Chris, you're looking very well anyway. I'm going to come down and see you on Monday night.
Okay, what, tomorrow?
Well, because you're doing a late night show. Monday night, yes.
Tomorrow night? Okay, yeah, yeah, pop down
I'll
tomorrow.
Come down and see you, darling, all right?
There's cheap drinks in Central Station tomorrow and all that. Are you at work at the moment?
I'm back to work on the 5th of February. So
that's my birthday.
I'm back on the 5th.
Yeah, that's my birthday.
Oh, God.
5th of February. What a day to go back. Well, you won't be able to bring a present round now. I'm so disappointed, dear.
All right, lovely chat, Chris. You take care.
Cheerio now. Bye-bye.
Bye.
There's lovely Tommy calling in. Very sad he lost his mum just a while ago. 020-8144-3477 if you'd like to call in tonight, OK? 020-8144-3477. I like to go back to these messages because I don't like to go too far behind, you know. Hello to Jason Carter. Sorted out your text problems. Yeah, it's all sorted out here now, Jason. Thank you. We're all working now. Everything's working now, I'm glad to say. What happened earlier? Did I tell you what happened earlier or not? Oh, yes, I did, didn't I? So the software didn't work. So what I did eventually to restore it, I restored the computer backwards, and then I deleted the broadcast software, and then I reinstalled it, and it burst into life again. So I'm quite pleased. That's how I got that going. Another phone call up to Manchester now, and Danny Davis is on the air. Hello, Danny.
Hello, Good evening, everybody.
All right, Danny, how are you tonight?
I'm all right, actually.
Are you going to make sure you sound a bit more lively than you did the other night, dear? Or are they all asleep again?
They're all asleep again, yes. So.
If you're wondering why Danny sounds a little bit subdued, I like that word, subdued. If you think he sounds a bit subdued, that's because everyone in his house is asleep at the moment and he doesn't want to wake them up because you are a considerate person, aren't you, lovey?
I am very considerate,
considerate,
yes.
Person. What stories have you got for us today?
Well, obviously, thanks for everyone for the kind messages about the new job. Thanks for them.
Danny's got a new job in Greg's the Baker's. Your manager, aren't you?
Store manager, yeah. It'll be my shop.
So does that make you the top cat in that shop? You're the top cat, or is there someone above you?
Yeah.
Fair.
And I've got the area manager, but that shop is mine.
Lovely.
I have control of that shop, so.
Have you ever done something like that before, then, managed a shop?
I used to be an assistant in Burger King when I was a young lad.
And that's the same sort of thing, isn't it, I suppose? Burger King, yes. Greg's, McDonald's.
Yeah, so yeah. The group's actually quite big because the group is called Euro Garages, and they look after Greg's, Subway, Burger King, KFC's, yeah. BT Garages. So they look after that.
What, that's all one big company?
Well, no, they're franchises. So Euro Garages is the name of the company, and then they'll have a Greg's franchise in one of their garages. They'll have a Burger King franchise.
Go on, sorry, I'm cutting you off. Go on.
So all of them are managed by Euro Garages. So they'll pay Burger King a set amount of money to have one of their stores in their garages. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. I mean, I'm a bit of a fan of the BP garages. I always find them pretty spotless and clean. And you can generally walk into them. If there's one thing I can't stand, it's having to go to a little window there. Oh, can you get me a bag of crisps? Or can I have a sandwich? Oh, what sandwich do you want? Oh, can I have something cheese and salad? And I come back with about 10 different sandwiches because I don't really know what you want. And you don't know what you want, really. You want to go in and pick something off the shelf. And virtually, I don't think all the Sainsbury's ones, they close at midnight anyway. The Esso ones you can't walk into. Generally, the Shell ones you can't. But the BP ones seem to keep their doors open. And there's certainly two. Even in London, there's two on the way home that I can use. There's one on Shepherd's Bush Green. Oh, that's an horrible place, that is, Shepherd's Bush. What a dump. Oh, my God. Awful, ghastly people walking around there, dear, at night. So Shepherd's Bush Green, there's one on there. There's another one. Just as you come through Hammersmith on the A4 before it becomes the M4. So I go to that one there. There is an SO1, which is just under on Chiswick Roundabout. And you could go in all of these, but the one I generally use is on the A30, which if you come off the M25, you go onto the A30, round a little roundabout, and you go on there. But I only ever use it to buy food. Either crisps, might get a cheese sandwich, cheese ploughman sandwich. And there's something about a cheese ploughman sandwich. I don't know if it's because it's been in that plastic packet for hours on end in a cool chiller cabinet. But they're delicious, absolutely delicious. And they've also now got a little Marks and Spencer's shop attached to that BP garage there as well. And they have... something cafe, what is it called? Bean Cafe, I think it's called. Bean Cafe, where they do all these like hot things and what have you. And you can order like a cheese and onion toasty or something like that, and they do it. So that's a bit like Greg's there, but they heat it up for you and cook it in there, which is quite nice. But I never ever buy petrol from them. They're so expensive, BP petrol.
Well, here's a little thing that you might not know, that Sainsbury's and BP use the same fuel.
Oh, I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised.
Because you can use Nectar points, can't you?
So yes, BP, that's right. Yeah, yeah. And Sainsbury's is generally the cheapest one, but not at the moment. They seem to have caught up, certainly the Sainsbury's here, with the prices of all the other garages around here. But I've found a golf garage, which is quite near the... the BP one on the A30, and twice a week they do cheap fuel. I think you've heard me saying that every Saturday. Yeah. And one random day during the week, which is usually a Tuesday, the Asian guy runs it, and he's very, very chatty. And again, it's another one you can walk into. But I hate having to stand at those little windows.
Oh, they're an absolute nightmare.
Do you drive at all, Danny?
Well, I do, but I don't have a car.
You haven't got a car at the moment, yeah. Well, where your Greg's is, will that be near where you live?
Yes, because I'm going back to Mum's. So,
oh, okay.
So it's pretty much about 15 minutes away from...
Oh,
from
she'd be pleased to have you there. She'd be pleased.
Yeah.
Nice to talk to you, Danny.
Cheers, I'll speak to you soon.
All right, have a lovely evening. Bye-bye, Danny. There we are, Danny calling in from Manchester there. Got someone calling in from a mobile. Who's calling in now, please?
Yes, hello, Chris Reardon. It's Keith George.
Oh, hello, Keith George. Are you in the United Kingdom as run by the delicious Theresa May? Or are you in Tenerife? T-E-N-O-R-E-F.
Tenerife.
You're in Tenerife?
Tenerife, yes.
And why is it Tenerife? Why is it Tenerife?
Well, you know, because a lot of people here have grief. I'm not one of them, of course.
No, of course not.
Well, no. But a lot of people here are very grief-stricken. You know, there's a lot of chiefs, a lot of Jimmy Smiths out here.
Oh, stop that now, dear. A lot of chiefs are not enough Indians. Is that what it is?
Oh, too many chiefs and not enough Indians, dear. All the school, too many people trying to... Too many cooks and not enough... What's it called? Too many cooks spoiling the broth.
Oh, really?
Dear. Gosh. But I was going to ring you and talk to you about, I've heard the tail end of your lovely conversation with regards to petrol stations.
Oh, yes.
And me.
Are
and
you hanging around those now, are you, petrol stations?
There are toilets.
go on.
When me and Nicky Vixen used to do the lovely two brews with you on a Thursday.
Just explain what you do and what Nicky did.
Well, okay. Everybody, if anyone that knows me, I'm a drag queen, and I also impersonate Boy George, and I'm a singer in my own right as well. And Nicky Vixen is a drag queen, and has been around a very, very long time. Used to work with the great Regina Fong and Millie Turner.
Has she got a BC after her name, like as in before Christ? Is that how long she's been around?
Nicky's not got a BC, no.
Go on.
She's got an OD.
An OD. Go on.
Yeah. So we used to do weekly runs at the two brewers, as you know, a month of Thursdays or a month whatever, and it was a very good, very lovely show we used to do with you. Do you remember?
Yes.
Yeah. Anyway, after we'd always used to stop off at the petrol garage. Now there's one as you approach, just go past Hendon, up towards going towards the A1. It's on the left hand side.
Okay, I don't really know.
We used to go in there regularly. Obviously, after the gigs and walk around. And there was one, it was ever so nice, very nice, a co-op attached to it.
Oh, yes, yeah. They've all got supermarkets attached now. Have you noticed that?
Yeah. And on this particular one, it had very good deals, like three somethings for £5 or, you know, very, very, we looked forward to going there after work. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
So, but one time we... When we missed that. Well, for some reason we came home a different way, not on the part on the North Circular up towards the M1 that way. We came another way, and we found this lovely petrol garage with a Marks and Spencers attached to it.
Oh, lovely!
It was a lovely one, and you know what? We never found it again, and we both said to one another, "Just a figment of our imagination." As it, you know, we've never been back there since, and we went, well, so we'll go to the other one, and we thought we remembered the way to get to it, and it was just nowhere to be seen. On that particular occasion, we didn't go any late night petrol garage shopping.
Isn't that
weird?
We
used to walk around singing whatever songs I'd sung, or, you know, and Nicky's not obviously not a singer, but he's walking around singing Cher, "Do you believe in love after love?" And the staff in there, they loved us.
But you've never found it again?
Never found it again.
Isn't that the weirdest thing?
Never found it again. It's in the Watford region, I would have thought, somewhere around the Watford area.
I mean, I know a little bit of what... Watford is the cheapest place to get fuel because there is this junction, and I'm sure you know where I mean. There's a junction in Watford. If you come off the M25, I think it is, and you go towards Watford, and you go along this road, and you come to a junction, and there's a Sainsbury's, there's an Asda... Yeah. And they're all competing, and it is the cheapest place to get... It's got to be the cheapest place to get petrol in London.
And also, just along from there, the drive-through McDonald's.
Oh, well, I don't go to McDonald's. I'm not a... do you go in there often?
Anymore.
You mustn't.
I don't go anymore.
You mustn't be eating that stuff, my love.
No, I'm not eating that stuff. I'm on a very strict regime.
Are you a bit over? Are you a bit overweight?
I found myself drinking quite a lot.
Oh.
So I've not drank any alcohol since New Year's Day, so I've been sober for 3 weeks.
Oh, well, that's good, yeah.
Very, very good. And I've got a personal trainer.
Right.
And I follow a very strict diet. So
Keith, you say you followed a very strict diet. So... Do you follow it? Strict diet?
I do. And so even if I could find that garage, I wouldn't be able to sort of buy any of the ready meals or whatever because they're strictly forbidden now.
Right.
So every day I have to get up and I cook the food from scratch.
Good. You know, so very good.
I walk 5 kilometres a day.
Where do you go?
I walk from my house and I walk 2.5 kilometres to another place called Los Cristianos.
Right.
And I do an hour's personal training at the gym and then I walk back. Now, the walk back is harder because it's uphill.
Of course.
So, I'm not drinking. And I was very disturbed because I got up to 93 kilos, which is 14 and odd stone, quite heavy for me, you know. Yeah. I don't think it's the biggest I've ever been. I think I've been bigger than that. But I've been doing this for like 6 weeks and then I got on the scale again and I'd lost something like 1.5 kilo. But you'd notice the change in my body where it's turned to muscle. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
My belly's gone down. I'm looking slimmer. I'm looking fitter. My arms have got quite big. My shoulders
excellent.
Are very big. My posture is excellent.
Excellent. I'm about 13 and a half at the moment. So
I was looking at you on your screen, and you know what, Chris? We've known each other for a very long time. You haven't changed much.
Yeah, everyone says that. Isn't that funny? But well, you know, when I get my clothes off and I look in the mirror, you know, when I'm having a shave, well, I've got a little towel around me and I have a little shave after I've had my swim, and I think, oh, God, I don't like the look of that. I do all the time. All the time.
What do you mean? You don't like from the neck down?
Yeah, from the neck down.
Oh. Mm.
And it's all round my middle. It's all stomach and handles round the side. But what can you do, dear? What can you do? Well, but I'm not really out to. I would be doing it for myself. I'm not really out to attract anyone anymore. I can't be bothered with it all. All the hassle you've got of going to a bar and trying to chat someone up or something like that. I can't be bothered. I'd much rather come in here and do something constructive. Like I feel tonight, I'm doing something constructive. Doing, shall we say, art?
Well, definitely, because you look at what you're doing is an entertainment. It's entertainment. It's part of the art. So you look very happy.
I absolutely love sitting here doing this. I really do. But this is, I was saying this on a show the other night. This is, I know this is like my limit. I'm fully aware of this. A lot of people over the years have said, oh, you should be doing LBC or something like that, and it has always been in the back of the mind, but I'm pretty sure that I'm not what they want. I'm not political enough. I'm certainly not that intelligent. I'm really not, but I can talk, and what I've found myself here is a little niche that I can do whenever I want. Whenever I've got a couple of spare hours, I come on and do this, and it works. The LBC thing, actually, a friend of mine knows someone at LBC and kindly started pushing, and I believe this particular person had a little look and said I wouldn't really fit into LBC, so that's great. Now, that's fine. Yeah. But I knew that anyway. And it's nice that that's come from someone who didn't slag me off or anything. They just said he wouldn't really fit into that to that. And he's already working in there. So I'm quite pleased to have heard that to sort of verify what I knew already. You know, you can listen. It's like you listen to other stations. And I think like a little BBC local thing. I think I could probably do that because that's all a bit, you know, oh, let's do the recipe of the day. And it's all a little bit like that, isn't it? And I could do that.
You did do radio. What station was you on?
Oh, Liberty Radio. That was in London, Liberty, yeah. That was right. And that was quite good.
Didn't you go, where was the one that was all like in Stratford?
That was Liberty, but I finished before it moved to Shepford. When I was there, the studio was in Knightsbridge, and I used to see the
Knightsbridge Radio Garden. Yeah.
Oh, it was lovely. Yeah. I used to park because I did overnight, so it was 2 till 6:30 in the morning. I used to park on the road right outside this place, and there was no one around, and I would see the sun come up over Harrods because we was at the sort of roof level, and I would see the sun come up over the roof. Amazing. So I did that, yeah. And it was overnight. And really, overnight, I was there along with David Rosen. And we had replaced a machine which kept breaking down. And so you'd be listening to the radio and then suddenly it would all go off. And you can't have that on the radio because you lose all your listeners. So that's why we were brought in for 6 weeks. Well, it turned into about a year and a half. And I loved doing that show. And at night time, they just left you alone, really. You know, they just left you alone as long as you didn't upset anyone.
Yeah. Excellent.
Well, you've done radio, though. You did radio for a while, didn't you?
I did. And the funny thing is, you know, like you, Chris, I enjoyed it. And I was doing weekend 12 till 4. And I don't know what it was. One day I went down to the studio. It was about 10 to 8 on a Monday morning. And there was no presenter there. And I messaged the presenter and I said, well, where are you? And they said, oh, I put the day off. There's no one filled it. And I said, no. So he said, where are you? I said, I'm in the studio. He said, well, do you want to jump on? So I said, okay. And I jumped on, and then all the producers were sort of like, what are you doing here? And I told everybody that I was on the radio, and then the listening viewers went up. And I got offered the breakfast show Monday to Friday, and I really enjoyed it. I did it for 11 months.
But it took over, didn't it?
It took over. And the thing is, it takes over, and I was getting up early in the morning after finishing doing 3 gigs a night.
No life.
You know, I was exhausted, and I started to go a bit cranky.
Yeah.
And then you get people coming in at 9:15 in the morning when their shift wasn't starting until midday, wanting to pre-record their shows.
Mm.
And having their children running around the studio like it was a zoo, and I just thought, is this worth it? It's affecting me. I'm not going to scream and shout. Do you know what?
When
I go off to performing in Las Vegas, I'm going to bow out of this.
Yeah.
And that's what I did, and unfortunately, it affected the station because a lot of the business that I built up with it and the sponsorship, when I left, they left.
Right. And did you find yourself in a permanent state of tiredness?
When I was doing it?
Yeah.
At first, no. But then it became more of a headache when people started coming in. It definitely started becoming a headache when people started coming into it. And then I just went, I was just exhausted.
Too much.
And the word was exhausted. And I just thought, no.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. You know, it's not on. But I did enjoy it. And obviously, you know, I've done my own, my nighttime natters and my...
Which you still do that, don't you?
Every now and then, but not...
when you want to.
Properly, regularly for a long time.
You do it when you want to, yeah. You do it when you want to.
But no, I will start doing it again. A lot of people... I used to do the daily sing song.
Yes, I remember that.
And also the weekly weigh-in and all these things. And a lot of people follow it. And I just... You know, when you just haven't got... Because you're tired... You lose interest in it.
Yeah.
So putting all my eggs into someone else's basket is no good for me. You know, if to profit them, and if they don't appreciate you, then my thing started to suffer. So I thought, no.
I hear what you're saying. I did a few online radio stations, and there's thousands of those now. Anyone can do the radio stuff now. Anyone can go on online radio. If you want to do it, you just go. You probably won't be paid for it. Very unlikely you'll be paid for it. But if you want to do a radio show, you can go and do one now. And I've done a few. But again, I found they were taking over. You know, I had to be here for a 10 o'clock show. Well, for an 11 o'clock show. What time did I do? I think I did 10 to 11. I quite like the 10 to 11 slot, and I did 10 to 11 every morning. Well, you've got to be in here 9:15 at the latest. Yeah. So I've got to be up here, get everything going, this, and then you do it. And then you've lost the day. You've lost the whole day, and there's just not time to do everything. And that's why I started, and then the whole talk thing was kind of an accident. I was on this particular station, and I found I had started listening to talk radio, in particular, a bloke called Mike Dickin. Have you ever heard of him, Mike Dickin?
No, I haven't. No.
Okay. He was on several stations, finally talk radio. And he was great. And I thought, I'd like to do something like that. And I found myself talking more and more in between the records, and less music was getting played. And in the end, I thought, this was on CMP radio, going back here about 13 or 14 years. And I just thought, well, I'll try a talk show.
Yeah.
And I did the talk show straight after. So I did a music show. And then for the next hour, it would be just talking. So I had a selection of newspapers in front of me, which I'd circled stories and bits and pieces like that. And I really wasn't sure what to do. And I put, this is before MP3, I was on CDs, I was playing music on CDs. So I put all the CDs away so I wouldn't be tempted to put one on. And I just did it, and that's how that started, really. Yeah. Oh. And then along came videos. Webcams weren't particularly good when they first came out. They were all pixelated and a bit jittery and all that. Yeah. And someone said to me, why don't you try putting a webcam in front? And I said, oh, no. You know, don't know about that. You know, while I'm sitting here doing my radio stuff, doesn't matter what I look like or anything like that. You know, just try it once. And I did. And that's been ever since, really. And that's how I did it.
Very good. But you mustn't talk to Chris.
If it's not a paid job, you can't let it take over.
No.
You know, I've got to admit, when I was working at the Black Cat for 18 years, that took over my life. It really did take over my life, the Black Cat. But nothing is really taking over me now. I just do bits and pieces that I want to do here and there, you know.
Yeah.
Would you like to do the radio again, or do you think, well, I've done that now?
I would. I think I enjoyed it. A lot of people said to me I was good at it, and you know, and I thought I was good at it. And I just, but to be honest with you now, Chris, I really haven't got the time.
No. Is that because of so much work, or what do you do with your time other than work then?
Well,
because you do a lot of flying between the UK and I always think it's Tenerife, don't you? You do a lot of flying.
I do a lot of flying. So I'm flying most Mondays and Fridays, or Fridays and Sundays, or whatever. But I've decided for the past few months, especially for the last 10 weeks, to do something for me. And so I get up. I'm going to be up tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock. And my day will start then at 9 o'clock. I'll be out, and I will be walking,
right?
And I'll be all done by 11 o'clock, and then I've got the day to myself. So I find myself doing things, keeping busy, and just relaxing. I've not got a care in the world.
Yeah.
At the moment, my mind's very clear. There's no clouds in it, you know. So, and that's the way I want to stay. I think if you've got a healthy mind, everything else just falls into place.
Yeah, I think you're right.
You know, it doesn't bother me sitting on the plane for 4 hours, Chris. Mm. As you and I know, you could be sitting in traffic for 4 hours.
Oh, easily.
It's going nowhere. Do you know what I mean?
I just got so fed up with the flying and mucking around at passports and having to wait in places and all that. It just did me head in. And then luckily last year I discovered caravan holidays. And you just get in your car, drive a couple of hours somewhere, and you're there. And that's it. And you walk in and it's your own little house for a week or whatever you want, a couple of days or whatever. I think I will buy one at some point. I'll probably buy a caravan, not a tow around, a static. And it'll be somewhere in between here and my sister's so that I can go and visit my sister. Because I've got a bit of a plan next year. I don't know if you know, I've already knocked out two nights now, Sundays and Tuesdays. I've knocked those out.
You've what? You're not working Sundays and Tuesdays?
No, Sundays and Tuesdays, I got rid of those.
Yeah,
Sunday went quiet, so I suggested that I leave. I could have kept it going, but I thought, no, I've done this now, so that, and I'm not looking to replace it. And Tuesday was a couple of little incidents, nothing to do with me, but there was no one to sort the incidents out. You understand what I mean? And I wasn't happy, so I thought, yeah, I'll let that go as well. So I've got two nights off now. I'm not looking to replace them, really. And next year, I'd like to lose another one. And hopefully, if I can get my nights together, so say Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and then Saturday, Sunday, Monday, I'm off. And then I can go out to my sister's. And I'd like to be a bit more involved with my nephew and niece's children.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah, because they're like 4 and 3 and 1.5. And when I go up there, I do have such a laugh with them. And I'm the mad uncle. You understand? I'm the mad uncle. Yeah. While they're all sitting there watching the telly, I'm behind the settees throwing the children around.
That's the fun uncle.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah.
And they're mad. They're as mad as me. And I've started teaching them to do my noises. Boop, boop. They're very good at them.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Keith, lovely to talk to you.
And you.
All right. Thanks for calling in and keep on the keep fit thing.
Oh, I will, Joe.
Have a nice evening.
Hello, love.
Bye-bye, Keith.
Bye.
How lovely to talk to Keith George there, boys and girls. That really is. I just put that... I have to do... If I put that in, then, see when people call again, I can remember who they are and announce them by name. How nice is that, eh? How nice is that? Some of your messages. Jason Carter says, the BP garages are, of course, the Wild Bean Cafe. I remember the Wild Bean Cafe. Yes, that's the one in the BP garages where you get nice pasties and sandwiches. Yum, yum, yum. Hello to Jean Evans. She's with us now. Hello, Jean. Rachel says, when I was a child, I was eating chocolate cake and there was a wasp on it. Oh, no. Before my mum could stop me, I took a bite and the bugger stung me in the mouth. My tongue swelled and my lips went blue. I was too young to actually remember what it was like, but I was in hospital for a few days and my mum had to watch me for 48 hours in case my lips went black. I was told my heart stopped twice. Can't phone because I'm falling asleep. Oh, come on, Rachel. I can wake you up, dear. Hello to Ronnie, who says, call me, get off the internet so I can call you. People are interested in you. You're not personality. Ronnie, you'll have to call on the house phone, or you can call in on the show if you want. You know the number, 020-8144-3477. I thought you was out tonight. 020-8144-3477 if you want to call in this evening. Okay, Jason says, big up the dry January. 22 days today. Well done, Jason. What, no drinks for 22 days? Very impressed. I don't drink at all. Only time I drink really is now and again a glass of champagne somewhere if we're out or whatever. It's very rare. We're talking like 4 glasses a year. Oh, look, it's Monday now. Hello, welcome to Monday. It's Monday the 23rd of January 2017 now. Hello to Martin Brooks, who's with us as well this evening. Thank you very much. Now, let's see. We're going to do the birthdays in a minute. Ooh, and good evening to... Oh, I'm missing things here. Rory's with us. Hello. Hello, Rory. Rory I used to work with in the cherry tree in Dulwich. Oh, it's very posh there, dear. Very, very expensive in Dulwich. Martin says, I was fab at the Black Cap. Oh, we had a lovely time at the Black Cap, didn't we? We really did. Lily says, I can fly with you, dear. Oh, no, no more flying, Lily. I don't want to do flying for a while. I really don't. No more flying. We'll get in the car and go down to those lovely caravan sites. I would like my own caravan at some point, you know, somewhere up there. Either near my sister, there's a particular park called Tattershaw Lakes Country Park. It's beautiful there. But the actual pitches are a little bit expensive. The oh, what do you call it, the annual, they have an annual fee for which certain things are included. You know, I think your water rates and that sort of thing are included. But the annual fee that the Tattershaw Lakes is a little bit expensive. Anyone else want to call in? 0208 144 3477. So there's a couple of incidents where I've nearly died. We were going to talk about that. We've been kind of gone off on a tangent this evening. Twice on my push bike. One particular time I remember, and I was married at the time, and we were renting a room in Earlsfield, which is in London, and I was working in Wimbledon. I was cycling down this road, and the disturbing thing is I remember cycling, and then I remember waking up in hospital, but I've no idea what happened in between. Absolutely no idea. I don't remember a car hitting me or anything like that. It's like a missing spot. Very strange. It was completely black. I'm blank there completely. So I remember cycling along and suddenly waking up in hospital with my bike next to me, which the ambulance people had brought in. Oh, he's coming round now, I think they said, or something like that, and tests were done and that sort of thing. So there's one incident where I nearly died. And the other one, I'm not so sure I nearly died. But I mean, there's a few more incidents. These were the ones I was going to tell you about. The other one, I was about 14, 13 years old. And we lived in Roehampton. And it was this adventure playground. I'm sure you might have seen one where you are. Adventure playground, which is a really basic thing with ropes and swings and all sorts of things that teenagers would go to in those days. You know, I don't think they go to these places anymore. And they had this swing which they'd made out of wood, and it was a great big swing on hanging on ropes. And I kind of jumped onto the side of this swing, and as it came down, my hip hit the kind of A-frame. So the swing was like this, right? Swinging like this on ropes. It was a big bit of wood. And I jumped on the side and it hit the A-frame. And my hip, I don't know why. I don't know why I'm still able to walk, to be honest. I don't know how I didn't break my hip on this particular machine. Well, it wasn't a machine. And these, when you think about it, these adventure playgrounds were blimmin' dangerous places. It was full of, like, unsawn or sort of unsmoothed wood. And you'd be climbing up a thing and you'd get a handful of splinters and ropes hanging down and nails sticking out. Do these places still exist, adventure playgrounds for children? Very, very dangerous indeed. They really were. 0208 144 3477 is my phone number. We're going to finish up shortly now. So if you want to call in, do it nice and quickly. Tommy Flynn, Selsey. Yes, Selsey is another lovely place for caravans. My neighbour just down the road, one, two, three doors down, Pearl and their family. They go to a caravan, Bun Leisure. I believe it is Selsey, which is down Bognor Regis, Brucklesham Bay, Chichester Way. It's really nice down there, Selsey. Yeah, there's a place where it'd be quite nice to have a caravan. But of course, that's not near my sister. You know, it's in the opposite direction. So probably wouldn't be able to do that down there. All righty. Anyone else want to call in today? 0208 144 3477. Otherwise, apart from that, we're due today's birthdays, which have just come up. There we go, because it's birthday time, boys and girls. Happy birthday today to Emily. Now, let me see, is that the Emily? Which Emily is this? Emily. Oh, no, so I thought it was another Emily there, my darling. Happy birthday today to Emily LaVigne. I think it's Vigne. Happy birthday, Emily. 33 years old today. So much younger than me, dear. Happy birthday, Emily. Happy birthday to top DJ Peter Martine. I haven't seen you for a long time, Peter. Now, when's the last time I saw you? God, I think it was in Central Station. Anyway, hope you're doing all right, Peter. Keep well, my friend. Happy birthday to Pete Martin. To Philip Kerr, who's 41 years old today. To Loren Matthew Wright, 24 years old today. And to Sally Monella, 31 years old today. Happy birthday to you all. Here comes the song. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Emily, Pete, Philip, Loren, and Sally. Happy birthday to you. All right? Have a nice Monday for your birthday there, boys and girls. Being Monday now, I will be hosting karaoke tonight. Every Monday night, that's at Central Station Bar in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. Starts at 8 o'clock on a Monday and finishes at 11:30. And there's cheap drinks as well this evening. One of the people that come to the karaoke is Maureen, who is getting to see this show tonight, because Maureen, I don't think she's on the internet, but I'm going to put this show on a little stick for you, Maureen. There we are. Is it? How big is that one? Oh, actually, it's going to... Oh, that's going to be too small. What have I got here for you, Maureen? Oh, I might have to go out and buy one. What's on this? How big is that one? Let me see. I can't even read it. 12 gig. Oh, well, put it on this one. I'm going to put my show on this for you, Maureen, and you'll be able to watch it, OK? Have a lovely Monday, boys and girls. Thanks a lot for listening to us.